wonderful thing about weddings, to me, is that it is an opportunity to talk about the fact that a marriage, the love that we have for a husband or a wife, there's more to it than just that relationship, right? There's more to it, at least in a God-ordained act of marriage. That is a representation, and His Word clearly states this. It is an act, it is a symbolism of the love that Christ has for His church, and that's the way that God describes it. Is this working? There we go, maybe. You guys hear me? The fact of the matter is that this thing that we get into of marriage is very clearly symbolized by the love that Christ has for His church. He died for the church. He calls the men to love their wives in that way. And that's probably my favorite thing to talk about at weddings. I love the pomp and circumstance and the ritual and the pictures and the music. It's all awesome. It's all fun. But I love that it gives us the opportunity to talk about the fact that God gave us this relationship in order to show us the type of relationship that He has with the people that He loves. That He sent His Son Jesus to die for the church. And that's the type of relationship that we are to have for each other. That everything that we do goes into that. So, that was one. Wash your clothes if you sit on the center aisle. That's kind of what we did there. Activities for kids. If any of the kids are doing activities, they're back there by the nursery there. We're going to have next week, or maybe the week after, next week, we're going to have, during the service time, kids, we're going to go back and send you back to the back. Again, we're going to be working on a Christmas program. Get excited?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm excited. One of my favorite things is to watch kids. Now, when I was a kid, they would put us up on stage, and the goal became to see who could be the cutest kid to mess around, to mess up, and so what ended up happening, especially as we got older as kids, you fourth and fifth graders kind of cover your ears and always listen to this part. But we would try to mess up on purpose, and then be able to figure out who did it in order to make all the adults think that was cute, and not like misbehaving, right? That was our goal. We probably had about, when I was in fourth or fifth grade, sixth grade, we probably had 12, 15 kids in that age group, and literally we had conversations about what we would do. So there was one year, I was always the biggest one, biggest kid, and so this one year, I was a fourth grader, they gave me the role of Joseph, because I was the tallest one, so I was the most likely adult, I guess. So we had to do this, and so I was holding the baby, Jesus, for some reason. I was supposed to just put him in the manger, thank you. And so I'm standing there, very, very, you know, dignified. It comes time for my part to lay him down in the manger, you know. And drop the baby Jesus right on the floor. So if we get to do that, yeah, and they thought it was great. Like, it was all, like, I'm still, like, they talk about that Christmas performance at my church still. Because you're never going to have to drop the baby Jesus. And so, don't do that. I'm looking at you. I see things in your face. I see it. Okay. Anyways, I look forward to Christmas time and the kids' Christmas programs because I want them to be able to learn the story of Jesus that our world has not gotten. Right? I don't need Santa Claus, but I love Jesus. And I want Christmas to be about Jesus. So, that's what we're going to do. Alright, now I'm done. Fun and all that stuff. We're going to talk about today, still the words of Jesus. We're going to jump back in chapter 5. Last week we talked about the eye for an eye makes the whole world blind. Jesus said, don't do eye for an eye anymore. Love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you, all that stuff. Now we're going to jump back a couple sections to chapter 5, Matthew chapter 5. Verses 13 through 16. This is the salt and light verses. So they're verses that we've probably all heard. You've seen, you know, churches will put up the images of a salt shaker and a match, you know, anyone on Facebook seen that picture of a match and they shine a light on it to make a shadow behind, and the illuminated part of the match, the actual flame, doesn't have a shadow. Kind of cool picture. Anyways, that's what we're going to talk about today. And just kind of fun story, we were at, my in-laws were in town Friday, and when they come in town, we always go to barbecues. So my mother-in-law loves barbecues, and I'm not eating that. You know, I just really love that. My mother-in-law loves barbecues. She gets the barbecue chicken flatbread every time, and I'm just like, give me some pork nachos. So we go to barbecues, and then they don't come to see us, you know, they come to see David. That's all I do. So we're in the back room of barbecue. So we walk through barbecue, it's like an interior room, like it's down the mall. There's no windows to the outside. There's some windows to the inside of the mall to get there. Anyways, we go to the back part where there's no windows anywhere. We're eating it at great times, delicious food. I got the summer sausage, smoked summer, was so good. And we get back there, we're almost finished eating. All of a sudden, the lights just go out. Everywhere. Pitch black. I mean, blacker than black, pitch black, dark, can't see anything, right? And I remember sitting there, and they came back on within literally just like maybe 3 seconds, right? They came back on, but the mall lights went out. There was zero light in this interior room. And I sat there, and I literally just got done talking to my father-in-law about what I was going to be preaching on today. That was going to be talking about salt and light. And literally, like, a minute later, the lights went out, right? Oh my God, what are you trying to tell me? But I'm telling you, it gave me, as I thought about it over the last couple days and the last night at lunch, I started getting this appreciation of the difference between darkness and light. Okay? Now, what light is supposed to do is it illuminates the dark, right? It actually gets rid of the dark. There is no darkness if there's light, right? You look around this room, you see darkness anywhere, mirror, and it's illuminated. Now, we have things called shadows, and we have these when something blocks the light, there is a darkness behind the thing that's blocking the light. Chew on that symbolism there for a little bit. If you want to be someone who blocks the light of Jesus, go right ahead, but there's only darkness behind you. Alright, I'm done with that. The idea though that light gets rid of the darkness. Right? We've all heard that saying before, that darkness is just the absence of light. Right? That's the scientific definition. Darkness is the absence of light. But I love this idea that the light gets rid of the darkness. So we were sitting there in complete and utter darkness. Like, I literally could not put my hand in front of my face and see it. There was no light to illuminate anything in that room. Pitch black, lights come back on, and immediately darkness is gone. Right? It's just gone. There is no darkness where there is light. And I love that thought, and we've got to figure out how do we apply that to our lives today. Where there is light, there is no darkness. And what does that mean in a world that is a very dark place? In our lives, when we struggle with things, when there is darkness sometimes in our lives, and we're trying to get this light, to get rid of that darkness. We don't want the light just to show us where the darkness is at. The light gets rid of darkness. And I think that I needed to see that. I don't think I would have thought that way about this message if those lights had not gone out. And then just a few seconds later, the light comes back on. And immediately it struck me, the darkness is gone. And I love that. So, I think it's a God thing. You can argue if you want. I think it's a God thing. All right. Matthew 5, 13 through 16 immediately follows the Beatitudes. Right? We talked about that a couple weeks ago. That to have less life, they are, you know, you can be poor in spirit, less life. Those who mourn, the meek, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, those who are merciful, those who are pure in heart, the peacemakers, and those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Those are the people that are blessed. And he immediately goes into this, you are the salt of the earth, right? He talks about people who are blessed because of all those things that they've done. Now you are the salt of the earth. If you're following those Beatitudes, if you're going to say, I want that, right? Because oftentimes we say things like, I want Jesus to save me. I want to be saved from my sins. I want to have life eternal in heaven? Absolutely. Give me that blessed life. You understand what I got to do? Yeah. I don't just get it. There's something that comes along with that. And that's what Jesus is saying here. If you want this blessed life, if you want to do those things, and I believe that many of us are called to those things, that we hunger and thirst for righteousness, that God gives us a desire for righteousness, that we desire worship because we want worship for us. We desire, the more we trust in God, the more we follow His Spirit, we desire to be merciful because we understand there's a correlation between being merciful and receiving mercy. There's something about the way the world works, and that's kind of the way it happens. We want those things. But now, want those things, you're going to do those things, and you're going to expect God to bless you either in this life or eternal life in heaven, then you are the salt of the earth. And that brings us to Matthew 5, 13 through 16. Let's read that together. It says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Heavenly Father, hear this today. As we read these verses, these words of Jesus, oh God, I pray that right now, even right now, that you would begin to move in people's hearts. That they would see a need to make a change in their lives. And as we discuss here going forward what those changes may need to be or where we need to have a different attitude or perspective in our lives, oh God, I pray that you would just speak to people's hearts. Right? May we pray. Three things I want to point out about this passage. Obviously, he talks about salt, he talks about life, and he talks about water. Okay, those are the three things I want to talk about. This verse on salt, it's just one verse, verse 13, a couple sentences there. This is a warning, right? This is a warning. It says, "You are the salt of the earth." This is not a thing about how to become salt. This is not a thing about what to do when you are salt. Basically, this verse talks about what's going to happen if you don't choose to be salty. Right? It's real salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can you make salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. There is a job to do for the salt. Right? Back in these days, the Palestine and what they would use the salt for, I was doing some research here on how they bought their salt. And they basically bought salt once a year. Right? They go to this market and they buy enough salt for the entire year. So you can imagine they throw this thing on the camel on the back, and this camel, like 3 or 4 camels, maybe eat one and just salt from their house. Because they use it for flavor, because the food was awful. And they use it for preserving things, because you got to get from Jerusalem to wherever you're going, the stuff's not going to last, right? And they didn't have, portable coolers that you could throw some ice in, like we got today, and keep our pot cold. They had to use salt to preserve this meat or whatever else they were transporting. So those are the two jobs that salt would do. What can we do if we are the salt of the earth? I believe that we are flavor for this life. How many people smile on that? We are the salt of the earth, right? We are the thing that brings out the good in the things that are not so good, right? My dad is a salt fiend, right? This is probably not good. This is probably why I look the way I do. As a kid, we'd go to a fast food restaurant, McDonald's, Burger King, wherever, and my dad would do the order of his meal. And he'd get up and, his fries, and he would take everything out of the bag that we got in, go to the drive and take out of the bag, and he would dump his fries into the bag, right? And then he would take like 3 or 4 salt packets and dump it on his fries, roll the bag up, shake it,
Go ahead.
Thank you. Not the cup choices, don't do that. But the salt brought out the flavor that he was looking for, that he was desiring, right? The salt was used to bring more to the fries. I like to put salt on eggs, I like to put salt on macaroni and cheese. It's just good. Salt's good. And we use it. Anyone watch Chopped? Anybody a Chopped fan? Yeah. Chopped's a pretty good show. But if you watch it for any minute of time, those judges are salt Nazis. If you do not salt your food, they're going to let you know. Okay? You've got to use salt to enhance, to bring out. And that is our job. To bring out the good that is out there in the world, to enhance it, to make things better. That is our job. As a job of salt, to go out there and be salty. Now, a cook has the option, right, to when to use salt, how much salt to use. So if we keep that analogy going, God is our cook. God is the one that's maneuvering things around. He's stirring the pot with all of us salty Christians, right? He's putting us all in different places. He's saying, okay, I need some salt over there. I need some salt over here. I need some salt in Bloomfield, Iowa. I'm going to put some people here in Bloomfield that are salty. And I'm going to let them hang out, make a change in their environment. I'm going to let them do some stuff that enhances what's going on there in Davis County. God has given you a job to do, to be salty, to enhance the community that you are in. God chooses and He directs our lives. And if we are following Him, if we are saying, okay, God, I believe you have put me here at this time, at this place, to be salty, we need to follow Him and we need to trust Him. That's what we do. And then we need to just step out and be flavorful. Be salty. Be an enhancement of the people around us. How many of you, and this is not no judgment, no anything, but how many of you sometimes feel like no matter where you're at, no matter what you're doing, life is just moving, right? Really? You gotta work? You gotta hang out with kids? You gotta hang out with my wife? Mow my yard? Gotta talk to my neighbor? I literally see Christians every single day, whether it's in person, our favorite thing, which is Facebook, I see so many Christians being so negative. I mean, they literally, it is the absence of salt in their lives, and it's driving me nuts. The salt of Jesus Christ saying, hey, I need you to enhance. I need you to make better. This is your job to bring out good in the things around you, the poor. I have placed you. You are my salt. I'm telling you where to go. I've already put you here. Bring out the good stuff. It drives me bananas. And I'm going to move on to the lights. Lights fun too. What's the purpose of light? I talked about it a little bit ago. But light is we use light to be seen, right? Light illuminates everything around it. To be seen and to see, right? We've got headlights on our cars to help us, right? My first driver, my dad told me the headlights are for other people to see you. You're bright so that you can see, right? Because you can drive without headlights and see out in front of you, usually the light of the moon or star or whatever you find there. But when you really need to see, you enhance it, give yourself more brights. The light headlights that you have are more for other people to see you. I was reading a story about Benjamin Franklin the other day and how he was the inventor of many things, but he's also the one who got Philadelphia to have street lighting, like lights out in their streets, right? So if you can imagine, back in that day, they didn't have cement or asphalt walkways. They had stone walkways, right? Like big round stones that you would walk on, and a lot of times you cut your feet or you stub your toe because it's dark, you can't see. So he would try to do this. And then he had this idea to persuade people. Benjamin Franklin was not a debater. He was a smart man. He did not want to debate people about his ideas. He had great ideas. But what he would do is he would convince them, persuade them through his actions. So he would put, what he did to get lighting out the street, he put a light just out in front of his own house. Right? Just put lit the candle, polished up the glass, lit the candle every night, and had this light. And then he lived in a part of Philadelphia where a lot of Main Street, where a lot of people would walk in the dark time, and they started to see the need for light. Are you friends with anybody living in darkness right now? Do you know somebody in your family that does not have the light of Christ to guide their lives? Your job as a light is not to yell at them to get the light. It's not to pound it in their heads because they need the light. It's to just be the light. So that they can see in their own darkness who the light comes from you. To be seen and to see. Whether you like it or not, and a lot of Christians don't like it, the world is looking at us as Christians to see what we're going to do, to watch what we're going to do. They want to call us hypocrites. They want to see us whether we're going to succeed or fail. And you have the opportunity to just be like. We get into this thing where we think we need to defend Jesus. Jesus doesn't need our defense. He just needs us to be alive. To show the world that's living in darkness who he is, based on what we do. Okay? It's impossible to hide. Okay, for Christians, and I'm getting excited because I love this. We are truly light, right? It says you are the light. No, Jesus said to his disciples, you are the light of the world, right? In John chapter 8, he says, I am the light of the world, right? In John, he said, I am the light of the world. Here he's telling us that we are the light of the world as well. Why is that? Because we have Jesus inside of us. Jesus is the light, right? That's coming out. So if we have Jesus, he is the light that's coming out of us. Holy cow, is that awesome and impossible to hide. It is impossible to hide. If you were going to be the light of Jesus and no one's talking about you, no one's noticing the fact that you're doing good things, no one's interested in you at all, something's wrong. We are not called to a private life of Christianity. Okay? We are called to a very public display of our faith because we are the tools that God has chosen to use to reach the world. To be the light of the world, to be salt to a world that needs enhancement, that needs joy, that needs peace, that needs to find some comfort in this dark time, in this bland, tasteless world that is out there. We enhance it. God has designed it that way, and we need to live that way. We need to embrace the fact that we are salt and light. And that means we have to act. We have to do things. Best part of this verse, of this passage. In the same way, let your light shine before others. Let Jesus shine out of you that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Why do we do this? Why are we salt? Why are we light? So that God gets glory. Amen? God gets the glory when we are salt and light. Your deeds, your good deeds that we want to do, that everyone wants to do, the good deeds themselves are not the light. Many Christians, way too many Christians, get caught up in the fact that if I do enough good deeds, if I give my money to the poor, if I feed people, if I do all this stuff, then I'm going to have whatever their desires are to leave things. There are so many people that do good deeds without the light shining out of them. The light has to shine out of you first, and then that light does what? It illuminates your good deeds so that others may see those good deeds and do what? Praise your Father in heaven. It has to start with the light coming out of me. If you want to start with good deeds, it's not going to last. It's got to start with the light coming out of you. In order for the light to come out of you, the light has got to be inside of you first. The good deeds come from the light. The light reveals what the good deeds are all about. And the good deeds are all about justice and mercy in this world that God gets to rule. God gets to rule. When I was imagining how I wanted to illustrate this today, the idea of a light switch. I couldn't get away from this on and off switch, right? Light, we could, that's order now, you shut the lights off, right? Maybe I don't do it, it's alright. We can imagine. But this idea that there's an on and off switch to light. There's not an on and off switch to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is inside of us. The power of the Holy Spirit is inside of us. When I see a lot of people, I'm going to include myself to this. We turn the power of the Holy Spirit off in our lives. Because we're angry at somebody, because job sucks, because money trouble, because whatever reason. Don't let Jesus lead in that moment. We just flip this little switch. And all of a sudden, there's no light coming from us. As I'm looking around even today, a lot of times you've got to make eye contact. I think this is true for all of us today. That there's an on-off switch in our hearts. And this light that we want to have flowing out of us. Flip it off. Just for a few minutes. God, I'm gonna turn you off just for a second. So I can relieve my carnal nature for a second. I can do this the way I want to, just for a second. And it's not a complete off switch, maybe you got a dimmer. I think that's where I'm all that's where I am. Jesus is not a switch to be turned off and on at our fancy. See, the Bible talks about things that we are supposed to do, and the Bible talks about things that we are not supposed to do. There are some black and white things in this world. And while I believe the grace of God covers those sins, and we give them to Him, and we confess them and repent, I also believe that each thing way too often, and we're in control. And that, I'm just going to go over here for a second, Jesus. Be right back. Put them on. Go to our thing. Sunday comes. Hey, buddy. Jesus. Glad I'm here. But the moment by moment that Jesus, you turn them off. You dim them down. And I know that this is kind of it's not fun. Think about the fact that we turn Jesus off from time to time. But when we do that, when we walk away, we're not changing our environment. We are not enhancing our environment. We are not adding salt. We are not illuminating the darkness. We're actually adding to the darkness in this world. We are not bringing light. So you turn that switch up. You say, give me a second, Jesus. I'm going to do my own thing for this new walk. What ends up happening is we come back. And there's a lot of people. You turn that switch off. Sunday comes, Wednesday comes, crisis moment comes, you'll put that switch back on. Jesus, thank you, you're still there. God, thank you. Absolutely, and He is there. He is there 100% of the time. So many times we put that switch and walk away, and every time it seems like it takes longer to come back. Everybody notice that? Put that switch off. Say, I'm just going to go away for a second. I'm going to do my own thing for a second. A second turns into a minute, turns into a year, turns into a lifetime. Staying away from God. Because you don't turn that switch back on. I'm here to tell you today, we can live a life where that switch is always on. Where that dimmer is always full and on. And the power of the Holy Spirit can live through us so that men and women, children, everybody in the world will see your good deeds and they will praise your Father in heaven. If you are living a life today where you shut them off, where you walk away, where you have moments where you say, I'm doing my own thing, where you have whatever comes up, whether it's situations, it's, you notice it for weeks or you notice it for months, or you're just playing a game. You come to church, it's faith. Because the light's not coming out and you turn that switch off a long time ago. God, I want you to have that light on all the time. And if you invite Him in to live through you, your actions will line up. Your actions will be done in a way that brings glory to God. No one's noticing you. No one's talking about what God's doing in your life. If you're not talking about what God's doing in your life, put that back on. Keep it on. Put a lock on that man. Keep that mind of Jesus bursting out so that men will see your goodness and pray to your Father. Would you stay with me again? There are people today here in this room that have their life flipped down, their switch flipped off. That God, Jesus, the light of Jesus, wanting to shine out of them, that you have turned them off. Maybe He's on right now. Last week He was off. Probably next week He'll be off. Because you haven't found a way to constantly live the life of Jesus Christ and have actions that line up with that. Jesus is very clear that we are to follow what He says. While leading forgives, He has mercy and grace, and it's bigger than anything we can imagine. We have the opportunity to live a life that pleases Him every single moment of every single day because He did something for us. He did the greatest thing for us by dying on the cross, saving us from our sins so that we do not have to have a life lived in hell and under damnation. We can have a life eternal in heaven with Him if we turn Him on, if we give Him free reign in our lives to do what He pleases, and we say yes to that. We have that option today. You have that option today. We have it every single day to choose to live the light switch on. Your light switch is down. It's in the off position. However you want to think about this, I want you to come today. I want you to come and kneel before Him in a humble gesture that says, God, I have to give my life to You. Every moment of every day I want to live for You because I'm tired of this back and forth. I'm tired of this roller coaster. I'm tired of just not having You lead my life. I know what it is to have that light switch off and to try to act like it's off. one facade, and you know behind that mask is living a life that is not ours. God is calling us today to say, no matter what is going on in your life, no matter what things are bringing you down, no matter what things you would think are sin in your life, you have the opportunity today, right here, right now, to say, God, I give it to you. And He will forgive you. He has promised already. He's already sent Jesus Christ on the cross to save us from our sins. The penalty is paid. The atonement is done. We can now just rest in the fact that He wants to redeem us. And you can have that today, right here and right now. Do you need to flip that switch on? Do you need Jesus Christ to live out of it? You do. I promise you today that you need it. If it's not there, come and get it. Come up here and get what God has for you, which is the light of Christ to shine for you. There is no guilt. There is no shame in anyone who accepts Jesus Christ, no matter what you've done in this world. Romans 8:1 says, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you choose to be in Christ, if you choose to allow Jesus Christ to come into your life and to live out and to shine brightly from you, there is not a single thing that you could have done in this world that brings you condemnation when you leave this world. You will enter eternity with heaven, with Jesus Christ, no matter what. No condemnation for those who accept His word. I'm going to pray. If you need the light of Christ to explode out of your life, I'd encourage you to come up here today. It doesn't mean that you're not a child of His. It doesn't mean that anyone's going to look down on you. It actually is the biggest sign of courage. Biggest show of belief and faith in Jesus Christ when you come down here and kneel at this altar. It says, I am not my own God. It says, I am not making my own rules. I am not making my own way. I am following the way, the truth, and the life. And I am choosing Him today. That's what coming forward means. And there's not a single person in this room who would not celebrate with you if you did that today. I would encourage you to come if you need to. Heavenly Father, Lord God, You are awesome. There is not a single thing in this world that will separate us from Your love, that is a promise from You, Lord God. And Heavenly Father, I pray that as You are speaking to people right now, that there would not be a single heart not touched by the fact that You have a plan. You have a purpose. You have a calling for all of us to change the world around us that You have placed us in. You have given us people to have influence over. And we need Your light to shine through us, to reach those. And Lord God, I know there are people in this room right now that maybe they've never even had Your light in their life to know what it is to let it shine forth. And Lord God, for those people right now, I pray that they would have the courage to come. To have the courage to come and ask You to give them the light of life that is Jesus Christ. To ask Jesus into their heart so that they can know what it is to be saved from their sins. Lord God, for those who have been saved, you know what it is to have Jesus Christ in their hearts. But maybe that light switches off. Maybe they haven't been showing the light of Christ in their lives lately. I pray for those that they would have the courage to come and kneel at this altar and be able to say, God, I need to show Your light. That is why I am here. And Heavenly Father, I pray that You would just give them the strength to come right now. To ask for Your light to shine out of them. Heavenly Father, for those that are living their lives in such a way that Your light is a beacon to the lost and to the dark world that we live in today. For those that are proclaiming Your good news everywhere they go, I pray right now for them, Lord, that they would continue to hold strong in that faith. And if they need some encouragement, Lord, that if they need a strengthening of their spirit, if they're beginning to get discouraged, that word, that you would strengthen them up today, so that they can come forward and heal at this altar right now and say, Lord God, don't let me falter. Let me stand firm in my faith that you are the God of everything, and I give you everything in my life. And I want to live my life with so much light shining out of me, the light of your love, the light of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord God, would you be power right now as we tarry just a little bit longer, as we hold here just a touch longer, Lord God. I know there are people that you are speaking to right now that have not yet come forward. You are here, your presence is here, you are speaking. Anyone walk out of here today is missing out on your love. I thank you for what you've already done in this place, at this altar earlier today. If there's anyone else that needs that same kind of touch, that same kind of victory, that same kind of accountability and love and faith and love for anything in their lives, I pray that they would feel led to come forward right now as well. That there's not a single thing in this world that we cannot come together and work together and help each other out. You have called us to carry each other's burdens. Help us to do that well in this church, Lord God. Heavenly Father, I thank you. Continue to be here with those who are gathered around this altar. Heavenly Father, lift us up. Would you like to come and gather around some that are praying up here? I would encourage you to do that. If you need to leave, please do so quietly. You can please just have a seat and lift up in prayer those who are at the altar right now. Come and join us in prayer.